have with us the MLK Choir, Rochester's Martin Luther King Choir, which has been in existence for over 40 years, and its director, Mr. Jasen Monroe, has been in that position for just almost as long. Today, he's actually a very young boy when he started. Today, we're going to have a reading from Martin Luther King's letter from Birmingham Jail. And that our orator today is Javauni Forrest, one of our own nurses on the 192 and in psychiatry unit. And he will be reading from excerpts from that letter. And along the way, the choir will join in this presentation. We are really thrilled to be able to bring joyous music today as the finale to this week-long celebration. So without further ado, Javauni Forrest.
Thank you, Dr. Olivares. So I'd just like to start by giving a brief history of the climate at the time that Dr. King was writing these letters while he was interned in Birmingham Jail. So in the spring of 1963, Dr. King led a boycott of white-owned businesses in Birmingham, Alabama, to protest against segregation, thereby defying a state injunction that prevented him from protesting without a permit. Scenes of the Birmingham Police Department's use of fire hoses and setting dogs on protesters drew nationwide attention. Dr. King, along with a large number of his supporters, amongst them hundreds of school children, were jailed. His supporters, however, did not include some of Birmingham's Black clergy, and a statement from the white clergy published in the Birmingham News denounced Dr. King's actions and urged African Americans not to support the demonstrations. From his cell in Birmingham Jail, Dr. King drafted this letter on the corners of newspapers that he was able to get a hold of. And in that letter, he outlined and defined his philosophy of nonviolence. The letter from Birmingham Jail reads, "Dear fellow clergymen, while confined here in Birmingham City Jail, I came across your recent statement calling my present activities unwise and untimely. Since I feel that you are men of genuine good will and that your criticism are sincerely set forth, I want to try to answer your statement in what I hope will be patient and reasonable terms. I am in Birmingham because injustice is here. I cannot sit idly by in Atlanta and not be concerned about what happens in Birmingham. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. We are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality tied in a single garment of destiny. You may well ask, why direct action? Why sit-ins, marches, and protest, and so forth? Isn't negotiation a better path? You are quite right in calling for negotiation. Indeed, this is the very purpose of direct action. Nonviolent direct action seeks to create such a crisis and foster such a tension that a community which has constantly refused to negotiate is forced to confront the issue. It seeks so to dramatize the issue that it can no longer be ignored. You express a great deal of anxiety over our willingness to break laws, and this is certainly a legitimate concern. Since we so diligently urge people to obey the Supreme Court's decision of 1954, outlawing segregation in the public schools, at first glance, it may seem rather paradoxical for us to consciously break the law. One may well ask, how can you advocate breaking some laws and obeying others? The answer lies in the fact that there are two types of laws, both just and unjust. And now I'll take a brief interim and welcome the MLK Choir.
Good afternoon, everyone. And we are glad to be here tonight. I am Jasen Monroe, and we do have a portion of the choir, the MLK Junior Community Choir. This choir has been in existence for over 40 years. I just took over the choir last year. But we are glad to be here. I'm swinging around to them. And we're just going to sing some songs in memory of Dr. Martin Luther King, and to ultimately give God glory and honor and praise for bringing us through and bringing us this far. Come on and see, all will see.
I'd be the first to advocate obeying just laws. One has not only a legal, but a moral responsibility to obey just laws. Conversely, one has a moral responsibility to disobey unjust laws. I would agree with St. Augustine that an unjust law is no law at all. Now, what is the difference, you may ask, between the two? How does one determine whether a law is just or unjust? A just law is a man-made code that squares the moral law or the law of God. An unjust law is a code that is out of harmony with the moral law. To put it in terms of St. Thomas Aquinas, an unjust law is a human law that is not rooted in eternal law and natural law. Any law that uplifts human personality is just. Any law that degrades human personality is unjust. All segregation statutes are unjust because segregation distorts the soul and damages the personality. It gives the segregator a false sense of superiority and the segregated a false sense of inferiority. Segregation, to use the terminology of Jewish philosopher Martin Buber, substitutes an I-it relationship for an I-thou relationships and ends up relegating persons to the status of things. Hence, segregation is not only politically, economically, and sociologically unsound, it is morally wrong and sinful. Paul Tillich said that sin is separation, is not segregation, an existential expression of man's tragic separation, his awful estrangement, and his terrible sinfulness. Thus, it is that I can urge men to obey the 1954 decision of the Supreme Court, for it is morally right, and I can urge them to disobey segregation ordinances, for they are morally wrong. Let us consider a more concrete example of just and unjust laws. An unjust law is a code that a numerical or power majority group compels a minority group to obey, but does not make that binding on itself. This is difference made legal. By the same token, a just law is a code that a majority compels a minority to follow and that it is willing to follow itself. This is sameness made legal. Now let the choir take it away.
Thank you.
We know through painful experience that the freedom is never voluntarily given by the oppressor. It must be demanded by the oppressed. Frankly, I have yet to engage in a direct action campaign that was well-timed in the view of those who have not suffered unduly from the disease of segregation. For years now, I've heard the word wait. It rings in the ear of every Negro with piercing familiarity. This wait has almost always meant never. We must come to see with one of our distinguished jurists that justice too long delayed is justice denied. We have waited for more than 340 years for our constitutional and God-given rights. The nations of Asia and Africa are moving with jet-like speed toward gaining political independence, but we still creep at horse and buggy pace toward gaining a cup of coffee at a lunch counter. Perhaps it is easy for those who have never felt the stinging darts of segregation to say, wait. But when you've seen vicious mobs lynch your mothers and fathers at will and drown your sisters and brothers at whim, when you have seen hate-filled policemen curse, kick, and even kill your black brothers and sisters, when you see the vast majority of your 20 million Negro brothers smothering in an airtight cage of poverty in the midst of an affluent society, when you suddenly find your tongue twisted and your speech stammering as you seek to explain to your six-year-old daughter why she can't go to the public amusement park that has just been advertised on television, and see tears welling up in her eyes when she's told that Funtown is closed to colored children, and see ominous clouds of inferiority beginning to form within her personality by developing an unconscious bitterness towards white people. When you have to concoct an answer for a five-year-old son who's asking, Daddy, why do white people treat colored people so mean? When you take a cross-country drive and find it necessary to sleep night after night Daddy, why do white people treat colored people so mean? And the uncomfortable corners of your automobile become no motel because none will accept you. When you're humiliated day in and day out by nagging signs reading white and colored. When your first name becomes nigger, when your middle name becomes boy, however old you are, and your last name becomes John, and your wife and mother are never given the respect of the title Mrs. When you are harried by day and haunted by night by the fact that you are a Negro living constantly at tiptoe stands, never quite knowing what to expect next, and are plagued with inner fears and outer resentments, when you are forever fighting a denigrating sense of nobodiness, then you will understand why we find it difficult to wait. There comes a time when the cup of endurance runs over and men are no longer willing to be plunged into the abyss of despair. I hope, sirs, you can understand our legitimate and unavoidable impatience. I hope this letter finds you all strong in faith. I also hope that circumstances will soon make it possible for me to meet each of you, not as an integrationist or civil rights leader, but as a fellow clergyman and a Christian brother. Yours for the cause of peace and brotherhood, Martin Luther King Jr.
Hallelujah.
Wow, that was fantastic. Thank you very much, MLK Choir. It was phenomenal. It was more than we could have hoped to have experienced tonight. What energy. I just want to remind everybody that this week we also offered in celebration of the memory of Reverend Dr. John Walker, who passed away a couple of weeks. He was a colleague of this apartment. He longed for preparations for MLK Week, and he would have been very proud to finish with music this event. So thank you very much. That concludes our program for today. Thank you, everybody, for attending.